cantavo in generazione per generazione annunziavo veritatum tua minore meo.
Oh, okay. So, will you give us a signal if we need to move on to the Gloria? Okay, so we're not, we don't...
You'll give me the
test.
Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto. Sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula
us. Tuss.
Amen. Tuss. Tuss. Amen. Tuss.
I have to drink something. No, I think we're good.
Thank you. We're a beautiful part.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Oh, what a lovely breeze. Oh,
yes.
It's like on a home week here.
Yeah. Are there any twos?
Did someone move the... Didn't tell No, there are no twos.
thy servant be. I will praise the Lord with all my heart. In the meeting of the just and all assembly, great are the works of the Lord, to be pondered by all who delight in them. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there also will my servant be. Majestic and glorious his work, his justice stands in forever. He has given us a memorial of his wonders. The Lord is gracious and merciful. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there also will my servant be. He gives food to those who fear him, keeps his covenant ever in mind. His mighty works he has shown to his people, giving serves me must follow me,
and where I am, there also will
servant be.
In the name of
Kyrie.
intera pax hominibus, bone voluntatis, ludo moster, benedici moster, adora moster, glorifica moster, gratia sagi magnam gloriam tua, Domine Deus Rex Celestis, Deus Pater Omnipotens, Domine Filii Unigenite, Jesu Christe. Domine Deus Sanctus Dei, Filibus Patris, qui tollis peccato mundi, miserere nobis, conie peccato mundi, suscipe deprecationem nostram, qui sedes ad dexterum patris, miserere nobis, quoniam tu solus sanctus, tu solus dominus, solus altissimus, Jesu Christe, cum sancto spiritu, in gloria Dei Patris. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The word of the Lord came to me thus. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I dedicated you. A prophet to the nations, I appointed you. Ah, Lord God, I said, I know not how to speak. I am too young. But the Lord answered me, say not I am too young. To whomever I send you, you shall go. Whatever I command you, you shall speak. Have no fear before them, because I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord extended his hand and touched my mouth, saying, see, I place my words in your mouth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our blessing cup is a communion with the blood of Christ. How shall I make a return to the Lord for all the good he has done for me? The cup of salvation I will take up, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. To you will I offer sacrifice of thanksgiving, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. My vows to the Lord I will pay in the presence of all his people.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, "Get up and head south on the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza, the desert route." So he got up and set out. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Candace, that is, the queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury, who had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home. Seated in his chariot, he was reading the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit said to Philip, "Go and join up with that chariot." Philip ran up and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and said, "Do you understand what you are reading?" He replied, "How can I unless someone instructs me?" So he invited Philip to get in and sit with him. This was the scripture passage he was reading. Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who will tell of his posterity? For his life is taken from the earth. Then the eunuch said to Philip in reply, "I beg you, about whom is the prophet saying this? About himself or about someone else?" Then Philip opened his mouth and began with this scripture passage. He proclaimed Jesus to him. As they traveled along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, "Look, there is water. What is to prevent my being baptized?" Then he ordered the chariot to stop. And Philip and the eunuch both went down into the water, and he baptized him. When they came out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more, but continued on his way rejoicing. Philip came to Azotus and went about proclaiming the good news to all the towns until he reached Caesarea. The word of the Lord.
Shepherd, says the Lord, I know my sheep, and mine know me.
Alleluia, Alleluia. Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
O Lord.
Jesus answered Andrew and Philip, saying, Amen, amen, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains just a grain of wheat. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will preserve it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there also will my servant be. The Father will honor whoever serves me. The Gospel of the Lord. Let Nicholas Case, who is to be ordained a deacon, come forward.
Present. Most Reverend Father, Holy Mother Church asks you to ordain this man, our brother, to the responsibility of the diaconate.
Do you know him to be worthy?
After inquiry among the Christian people and upon the recommendation of those responsible, I testify that he has been found worthy.
Relying on the help of the Lord God and our Savior Jesus Christ, we choose Nicholas, our brother, for the order of the diaconate. Thanks be to God. God's calling comes in different ways, and each one who has received God's call, they all have their own story, and seems like it's almost tailor-made, each one taking a different path and discerning that call and responding. We see this also in the life of the prophets of the Old Testament. We can think of the call of Isaiah, for example, when he has his vision of heavenly worship when he's in the temple, and God, it's sort of an indirect call, whom shall I send? And Isaiah enthusiastically responds, here I am, send me, with much alacrity. We can contrast that with the call of Jeremiah, which we heard in our first reading for Mass today. He seemed to be a bit resistant. This happens sometimes when God gives a call. He was resistant and saying he's too young. It seems like he was finding excuses. I sometimes wonder if the real reason was he foresaw what was going to happen, because Jeremiah had a very hard time of it. He was subject to much harsh treatment, persecution. The authorities did not like the message he was proclaiming, which was God's truth, so much so that they tried to take his life, threw him into a cistern. He was put into stocks overnight, all for proclaiming God's message. And yet, such suffering in some form or another is always a necessary part of being an authentic spokesman for God. Our Lord teaches that in our gospel reading today, this teaching about the grain of wheat. It needs to fall to the ground and die, or else it doesn't produce any fruit. It remains just a grain and it dies. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. Then he says, whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will preserve it for life eternal. So there's a sense of what one has to renounce, the suffering one must be willing to endure in order to be an authentic spokesman for God. It's the price that comes that has to be paid for being God's servant. But our Lord also says here, whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there also will my servant be. Where I am, my servant will be. Where I am, because he has modeled this for us. His servant is following the pattern he has set in his own passion and death. There, the servant follows. And this is what it means to be great in God's eyes, as our Lord also teaches here. The Father will honor whoever serves me. That is how we find offer of our lives a pleasing sacrifice to God. But it's not just a matter that we have to put up with all kinds of suffering and harsh treatment and be sad in this life so that we can have the payoff when we die and have a nice, comfortable life in heaven in the hereafter. It's much more than that. Later on in Jeremiah, when he's going through all of this harsh treatment, we hear his famous soliloquy about how the Lord duped me. You duped me, O Lord. It's like the Lord tricked him into being his servant because of so much suffering. But he cannot keep the word of God within. He cannot but proclaim God's word. By God's providence, it just so happens that this will be the first reading for our Mass tomorrow, the 22nd Sunday in Ordinary Time, when it just so happens Nicholas will give his first homily. There will likely be times in your life, Nick, when you will see this as a sign of things to come. It happens in every vocation. But this is what the vocation means, that you cannot be who you are without fidelity to what God has called you to do with your life, no matter what that call might be. To renounce that would be to renounce your very self, to violate who God created you to be. So Jeremiah, despite all this suffering, he cannot but proclaim God's word because he can't be true to himself and to whom God called him to be. I see this in another way as well in the story we heard about in the Acts of the Apostles with this Ethiopian eunuch who converts under the direction of Philip, what certainly must have been the shortest RCIA process in the whole history of the church. But that's okay. The faith was brand new, so there was less to cover. So our parishes can't do that. But he's moved under the direction of Philip and is laying open the word of God to him. He asked to be baptized, and then the reading says he continued on his way rejoicing. We can sure that he went himself spreading the good news. And good news is like that. That's another thing about our human nature. When you have really good news, you cannot help but share it with other people. When you find out you graduate at the top of your class, or a couple who gets engaged to be married, or you land your dream job, something really difficult for you, a class you were struggling in, weren't sure if you're going to pass, and you get an A. These kinds of good things that happen to us, we can't keep them inside. We need to share that good news with others. All the more so then for what is truly good news, the only good news that is of true and lasting value, that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior and has given us the gift of eternal life by his death on the cross and his resurrection from the dead. We see this motivation in Philip himself as well, who catechizes this Ethiopian. He goes to Ethiopia. Think about the ancient world at that time. Ethiopia was the hinterlands. It was beyond even the furthest boundaries of the civilized world. The Acts of the Apostles is telling us that the gospel is now reaching to the furthest corners of the earth. The apostles are fulfilling the command that the Lord gave them. Philip cannot help but bring that good news wherever he possibly can get to. So it's that same kind of burning desire to share good news. He goes all the way out to the peripheries, one of the favorite words of our Holy Father, Pope Francis, who constantly reminds us to do that. And as he points out, peripheries are not just geographical, they're also existential. We are certainly facing the reality of existential peripheries in our own time, right here in our own place. The homeless, drug addicts, victims of domestic abuse, undocumented, and now all the more so, the distress that so many are experiencing as a result of the current pandemic. We have to worship outdoors. Thank God we have mild elements to deal with today. It's a bit of an inconvenience, but this is nothing compared to the hardship and distress so many people are experiencing today. There are many existential peripheries, people living on existential peripheries who need the good news brought to them. And so this is why the church has ordained ministers to do that. But there's something else about Philip we can see as an ordained minister. The Philip here in the Acts of the Apostles is one of the seven reputable men who are mentioned a little bit earlier in the Acts of the Apostles who were appointed to assist the apostles with the administration of the temporal goods. They were getting dragged too much into the weeds of this administration. So they entrusted this to these seven reputable men. What we see as the precursors to the order of deacon. And so it's not Philip the Apostle who is mentioned in the gospel. And this scene takes place shortly after his ordination. As the reading says, when they selected these seven men, they presented these men to the apostles who prayed and laid hands on them, the right action of the rite of ordination. It's shortly after this that Philip goes out. They were appointed and ordained to attend to temporalities, but not only. We see very clearly from the start, they also went out to proclaim the gospel. This role of the deacon is also illustrated in the rite of ordination, as after the laying on of hands and the prayer of ordination, Nick will be vested with the vestments of the order of deacon, the stole and the dalmatic, and then presented the book of the Gospels. Presenting the book of the Gospels, the deacon is also to go and proclaim the gospel. This tells us that the roles of service in the church all have as their ultimate end the service of the gospel, whether that's directly preaching the gospel or even attending to temporalities and matters of administration, education, everything that God calls his people to do. All is a role in some way or another, ultimately for the service of the gospel. And every vocation is a way to serve the gospel. We see that in our readings for our ordination mass today, whether that's the apostles themselves, whether it's deacons going about and preaching, or the basic Christian vocation to bear witness to the good news and share it with those that Christians come into contact with, as was the case with the Ethiopian in the story from the Acts. For those in holy orders, they exercise their role in the communion of the church's ordained ministers in the local church under the supervision of the bishop who is literally the overseer. They dispose themselves at his direction to go where they need to go and to take on whichever role of service best serves the local church for the proclaiming of the gospel. We give thanks to God today for the vocation of our brother Nick, who has discerned and responded to God's call to ordained ministry, and ultimately please God as a priest to offer the sacrifice of reconciliation to God for the sanctification of God's people. This last step before priesthood, the order of deacon, signifies that the priest as well is called to serve, and all of his service, all of the roles he fulfills is for the proclamation of the gospel. Thank you, Nick, for your yes. And when I present that book of the gospel to you, after the prayer of obedience, the promise of obedience, that promise of obedience is what makes possible this hierarchical communion among those in holy orders and the coordination of evangelical activity under the oversight of the bishop. Then you make that promise of obedience, and then I pray that God will be pleased with what I will pray on your behalf at that point, that may God, who has begun the good work in you, bring it to fulfillment. Dear son, before you enter the order of the diaconate, you must declare before the people your intention to undertake this office. Do you resolve to be consecrated for the church's ministry by the laying on of my hands and the gift of the Holy Spirit?
I do.
Do you resolve to discharge the office of deacon with humble charity in order to assist the priestly order and to benefit the Christian people? You resolve to hold fast to the mystery of faith with a clear conscience, as the apostle urges, and to proclaim this faith in word and deed according to the gospel and the church's tradition.
I do.
You are prepared to embrace the celibate state. You resolve to keep forever this commitment as a sign of your dedication to Christ the Lord, for the sake of the kingdom of heaven and the service of God and man.
Do
you resolve to maintain and deepen the spirit of prayer that is proper to your way of life, and in keeping with this spirit and what is required of you, to celebrate faithfully the liturgy of the hours with and for the people of God, and indeed for the whole world?
I do.
You resolve to conform your way of life always to the example of Christ, of whose body and blood you are a minister at the altar. You promise respect and obedience to me and my successors.
I do.
May God, who has begun the good work in you, bring it to fulfillment. My dear people, let us pray that God, the all-powerful Father, will mercifully pour out the grace of his blessing on this his servant, whom in his kindness he raises to the sacred order of the diaconate.
Let us kneel.
Have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Holy Mary, Mother of God,
pray for us, Saint Michael.
Pray for us, holy angels of God, pray for us,
Saint John the Baptist.
Pray for us,
Saint Joseph.
Pray for us,
Saint Peter and Saint Paul.
Pray for us,
Saint Andrew.
Pray for us,
Saint John.
Pray for us, Saint Mary Magdalene. Pray for us,
Saint Stephen.
Pray for us,
Saint Ignatius of Antioch.
Pray for us,
Saint Lawrence.
Pray for us, Saint Perpetua and Saint Felicity. Pray for us, Saint Agnes. Pray for us,
Saint Gregory.
Pray for us,
Saint Augustine.
Pray for us,
Saint Athanasius.
Pray for us,
Saint Basil.
Pray for us,
Saint Martin.
Pray for us,
Saint Benedict.
Pray for us,
Saint Francis and Saint Dominic.
Pray for us,
Saint Francis Xavier.
Pray for us,
Saint John Vianney.
Pray for us, Saint Catherine of Siena. Pray for us, Saint Teresa of Jesus. Pray for us, all holy men and women, saints of God. Pray for us.
Lord, be merciful.
Lord, deliver us, we pray,
from all evil.
Lord, deliver us, we pray,
from every sin.
Lord, deliver us, we pray,
from everlasting death.
Lord, deliver us, we pray,
by your incarnation.
Lord, deliver us, we pray,
by your death and resurrection.
Lord, deliver us, we pray,
by the outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Lord, deliver us, we pray.
Be merciful to us sinners.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Jesus, Son of the living God,
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Christ, hear us.
Christ, hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us.
Lord God, mercifully hear our prayers, and graciously accompany with your help what we undertake by virtue of our office. Sanctify by your blessing this man we present, for in judgment we believe him worthy to exercise sacred ministries, through Christ our Lord.
Let us stand.
Draw near, we pray, Almighty God, giver of every grace, who apportion every order and assign every office, who remain unchanged, but make all things new. In your eternal providence, you make provision for every age, as you order all creation through him who is your word, your power and your wisdom, Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You grant that the church's body, adorned with manifold heavenly graces, drawn together in the diversity of its members, and united by a wondrous bond through the Holy Spirit, should grow and spread forth to build up a new temple. And as once you chose the sons of Levi to minister in the former tabernacle, so now you establish three ranks of ministers in their sacred offices to serve in your name. And so in the first days of your church, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, your sons apostles appointed seven men of good repute to assist them in the daily ministry, that they might devote themselves more fully to prayer and preaching of the word. By prayer and the laying on of hands, they entrusted to those chosen men the ministry of serving at table. We beseech you, Lord, look with favor on this servant of yours, who will minister at your holy altar, and whom we now humbly dedicate to the office of deacon. Send forth upon him, Lord, we pray, the Holy Spirit, that he may be strengthened by the gift of your sevenfold grace for the faithful carrying out of the work of the ministry. May there abound in him every gospel virtue, unfeigned love, concern for the sick and the poor, unassuming authority, the purity of innocence, and the observance of spiritual discipline. May your commandment shine forth in his conduct, so that by the example of his way of life, he may inspire the imitation of your holy people in offering the witness of a clear conscience. May he remain strong and steadfast in Christ, so that by imitating on earth your Son, who came not to be served but to serve, he may be found worthy to reign in heaven with him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
House of the Lord. I mourn for the house of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for joy to the living God.
Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest to shelter.
My prayer. Hearken, O God of Jacob.
I long
for the house of the Lord.
Receive the gospel of Christ, whose herald you have become. Believe what you read, teach what you believe, and practice what you teach. Peace be with you.
If anyone serves me,
my Father, sacrifici.
Tibi celi et universae potestates, tibi cherubim et seraphim in cessabili voce proclamant.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Holy Father, whose Son chose to wash the disciples' feet, and so set an example, accept, we pray, the oblations of our service, and grant that offering ourselves as a spiritual sacrifice, we may be filled with the spirit of humility and zeal, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you made your only begotten Son high priest of the new and eternal covenant, and by your wondrous design were pleased to decree that many ministries be exercised in the church. For Christ not only adorns with the royal priesthood the people he has made his own, but with a brother's kindness he also chooses men to become sharers in his sacred ministry through the laying on of hands. He chooses them to lead your holy people in charity, to nourish them with the word, and strengthen them with the sacraments. As they give up their lives for you and for the salvation of their brothers and sisters, they strive to be conformed to the image of Christ himself and offer you a constant witness of faith and love. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, and in exaltation we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Dominus Deus.
You therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or the offered for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas, and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for your servant, whom you have been pleased to raise to the order of the diaconate, and in your mercy keep safe your gifts in him, so that what he has received by divine commission he may fulfill by divine assistance. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Mysterium Fidei.
Non tuam optiamus
Domine, et tuam resurrectionem confitemur, donec veniat.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the blessed passion, the resurrection for the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them, as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who, through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Deus Domini in eternum cantavo. In generationem et generationem annuntiavo veritatum tuam in ore meo. Ego. Testamentum electo meo, jura vita vir servo meo.
Ego.
Buntur celi mirabilia tua Domine, et enim veritatem tuam in ecclesia sanctorum.
Ego.
Locutus es in visione sanctis tuis et dixisti. O sui adiutorium impotente, et exaltavi electum te plebe.
Ego.
Thank you.
Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
Sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, to your servant, whom you have replenished with heavenly food and drink, that for the sake of your glory and the salvation of believers, he may be found faithful as a minister of the gospel, of the sacraments, and of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Before we conclude, I just wish to issue a word of thanks to Father Luello Blackbach and your parish here at St. Raphael for hosting us for this ordination. You really pulled all the stops for us. So. thank you for your gracious hospitality, and of course, congratulations to you, Nick. Thank you to your parents, and thank all of you. Thank you to all of you for participating in this ordination mass today.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
Nicholas, may God, who has called you to the service of others in his church, give you great zeal for all, especially the afflicted and the poor. May he who has entrusted you with preaching the gospel of Christ help you as you live according to his word, to be a sincere and fervent witness.
Amen.
May he who has appointed you a steward of his mysteries make you an imitator of his Son, Jesus Christ, and a minister of unity and peace in the world.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless all of you who are gathered here, the Father and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Sanctum fructum ventris tui.
Et in saecula saeculorum.